Greg Miller from Up at Noon. Sometimes when I'm alone at night, I wonder if there is anything to this life or existence is just a cruel trick played by chemistry and evolution. Oh, you're here to see the Gary Whitta Walking Dead interview? I'm sorry, here it is.
As I live and breathe, Gary Whitta.
Oh.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. No, please. It's our pleasure. Trailer, it looks pretty good.
That was actually my first time seeing it as well, and I was somewhat blown away by it. It looks really, really cool.
Bring people up to speed here right now. Right? Telltale Games, known for adventure stuff, mm-hmm. Back to the Future, most recently Jurassic Park. Mm-hmm. Now they're taking on Walking Dead. What is your role in it, and what is the game about?
So I'm working with the Telltale guys as the story consultant across the whole series of the game, which is to say that it's 5 episodes. Uh-huh. So, you know, Telltale make episodic story games, and it's 5 episodes. So I'm the story consultant working with them across the whole series, helping them figure out the story, where they want to go with the characters, kind of the big picture story stuff. And I'm also writing 1 of the 5 episodes as well. Oh, so yeah. That's going to be a
finally
a lot
doing
of fun.
Some real work.
Yeah, exactly.
Not just you've ridden Robert Kirkman's coattails this far now. You're smoking a cigar with a hat on saying this is where the story goes.
So far it's been very easy. I go to the Telltale offices a couple of times in the week and I say, "Don't do it like that. Do it like this." And they're like,
"Oh, he's brilliant."
Good luck with that, guys. I'll be going now. So, you know what you should do? You should make that part really awesome and terrifying and emotionally heart-wrenching. Where's my check?
Check.
Yeah. But at some point, I do actually have... I'm running episode 4.
Okay.
And so episode 1 is coming out next month, and the series will be on a regular basis after that. And so at some point, very soon, I have to write the 4th episode.
Yeah, you got
to
get it together.
Which is actually good because the way the story is designed, it became the same way as a TV series might. You know, you build up to a season finale. The story becomes more kind of... horrible and horrific and nasty as the story progresses. So by the time you get to episode 4, without giving you any details, I get to write some pretty bleak, very sick stuff.
That's just right up your alley.
That's why they came and found me.
So you gave me a great segue there. You're talking about season finales. Last night, Walking Dead ends. Season 2 done for the mm-hmm. series.
Yeah.
Season, I should say. This game obviously picking up right after that, correct?
Well, no, not really.
I'm happy to
disavow you of that notion. I should stress this: the video game version of The Walking Dead is based on the comics and has no connection at all with the TV version. They're totally separate things. Mm-hmm. In the same way that the TV people came and went off and adapted the comics in their own way, Telltale are taking going back to the source, the original comics, Robert Kirkman's comics, and making their own adaptation. And in fact, what we're doing with the game is a far more liberal adaptation of the comics than the TV show is. If you know the comics and the TV show, you know that they're basically the same characters, the same basic storyline, but they're, you know, kind of making little deviations as they go. What we're doing with the game version is starting completely fresh, same universe, same time and place. You know, it's in and around Atlanta at the same time as the zombie apocalypse, but there's no Rick Grimes, there's none of the major characters are in the new game in a major way. Because how many times can you really keep telling the story of that one set of characters?
I'm already sick of Lori again on the show.
Shut
up, we get it. You're pregnant and whiny. Fuck.
No comment.
Okay, oh, yeah. But you get to introduce new characters. You're bringing this guy Lee,
and so
right?
That's the fun thing, is that we didn't want to go back and just do Rick's story over again. So we've created a completely new set of characters who are, it's a similar kind of group. Like, it's a disparate group, you know, and they're often as much a threat to themselves as the undead are. And there's all the kind of the interpersonal, you know, drama that plays out within that. So it's a very good group. There is a little bit of crossover. Like, for example, in the first episode, Glenn is with you. And then you have a little adventure with him. And then he goes off to join Rick's group. So you can kind of see where the universes intersect.
Gotcha.
But once that happened, Herschel's farm is a location later in the game. There are places where we kind of cross over into some of the DNA of the original comics and stuff that you might recognize from the TV show. But it's very much its own story. So our main character is a character called Lee, who was purposely designed to be a very different character to Rick. So Rick Grimes is a sheriff, right? He's a lawman. Lee is a character who's on the other side of the law. He's actually a guy that's been convicted of murdering his wife. And he's on his way to jail when the apocalypse happens, and that's how he kind of breaks free.
Lucky break.
Yeah, yep.
We could all be so lucky, am I right?
Good. Don't touch my knee.
No, sorry.
So it's a the proximity is enough.
Okay.
The story is very different from that point. You're very different. Still a moral character, still the guy that, you know, a heroic character.
Yeah.
But like one of the very early challenges you have is do you tell the group who you really are and what your backstory is? Mm-hmm. If you're honest with them about who you are, they may trust you less. So the whole game is really based on making, you know, agonizing moral choices, you know, because obviously the whole...
Fun.
Yeah. I tell you, it's fun for me, particularly because I come from a world where it's fun to create fictional characters and torture them by putting them in impossible situations where they have to make really difficult decisions. For a video game, it's actually even more fun because now you get to torture the player. Because it's real people that now have to make those agonizing decisions. And so we have a lot of fun sitting around at Telltale going, like, what would people really hate to have to choose between? And then make them, force them to make that kind of choice.
So now, how is The Walking Dead merging with the games Telltale puts out, right? Like, it was one of those things where I reviewed Back to the Future for IGN, and I thought it was great, really true to the source material. It's paced well, and it was all about dialogue, right?
Yeah.
And then Jurassic Park, I reviewed and liked a little bit less.
Right.
I mean, it was trying to be action, but a raptor would sit there and wait for me to make my choice. And
right.
Stuff. And this is debatable. I know Telltale's, like, wringing their hands somewhere. But now you bring in Walking Dead, and you have, you know, we have roamers, and we have walkers, and we have slower-moving zombies. Is that all working in? Is it the same kind of DNA? We saw a little bit in the trailer.
Yeah, I think in some ways what they're doing with The Walking Dead is more like the traditional adventure games. When, you know, back in the days, like Back to the Future and Sam and Max and Monkey mm-hmm. the Monkey Island games that Telltale made. This is more, I think, in that tradition. It's a little less action, a little more story. Like when I was first approached and they said, do you want to work on The Walking Dead? I was a little bit reticent at first because they didn't know exactly who was doing it or what kind. I was like, maybe is it going to be like another Left 4 Dead type game? Where yeah. in those kind of games, there's not a lot of room to tell a story. And as soon as they said Telltale, I knew who Telltale was. Like, okay, sign me up, because I knew that they make the kind of games where there's opportunity to really let the narrative take center stage and tell a story and flesh out characters and then tear the flesh off those characters, you know, because that's a unique benefit of working in a universe like The Walking Dead where people are getting murdered and torn apart all the time.
Easy.
So it's very story driven, and what's interesting to me is it's very choice driven. I think it's less of, you think of adventure games typically as puzzle based,
yeah.
intellectual challenges. How do I get through this door? How do I open this box?
Banana in the light socket.
Yeah, exactly. Put the green banana in the red door and that kind of stuff. And you know, we grew up on adventure games and we know that. And that intellectually is interesting. These kind of intellectual puzzles and challenges are interesting. But what I think is more interesting about a game like this, where it's more choice driven, mm-hmm. is that it's an emotional challenge. It forces you into those impossible situations where you're like, what kind of person are you really? You got to make a snap decision very quickly, and they're very rarely easy or good decisions. It's really kind of like pick your poison. This is horrible in a different way, but you know, you've got to choose something, and you then live with the consequences of the decisions that you made. So I personally, for me, like as a storyteller, that is a more interesting engine to drive the game than just, you know, puzzle-based stuff.
So I mean, had you been reading The Walking Dead before? I mean, was this kind of a natural progression for you?
Yeah, so I mean, it's weird that a lot of these connections were kind of already there. Robert Kirkman's a friend of mine. He and I actually have the same agent, and this is how it all kind of came together. Is that I knew Robert and played a zombie in the pilot episode of the TV show because I called Robert and said, "Come on, you gotta get me on there." And he was kind enough to let me go to Atlanta and be a zombie in the pilot episode. And then later down the road, they called me and said, "Well, do you want to work on the video game?" And like I said, it was kind of a no-brainer for me. So
what is Robert Kirkman's involvement with this? I mean, he's split. You know, he's on the comic side, he's writing Invincible, Walking Dead, Wolfman. Then he's doing the TV show. He's in the writer room there. And
yeah.
How much time does he come up here and order you around so you can then go order other people around?
Yeah, I don't know how Robert does it. Like you said, he writes all these comic books. The Walking Dead is obviously, he's actually kind of living in two universes of The Walking Dead right now, because or three if you count the game as well, because he's way ahead in the comics. He still has the comics every month. He moved to LA. I mean, he now lives in LA to help run the TV show. He's very closely involved in that. You know, he writes episodes, he supervises everything. And now he's closely involved in the game as well. He signs off on everything. You know, he comes in and looks at the game and says, "Do this, don't do that," or "I like this," or "That isn't the way I would have done it." And his presence is always really keenly felt. Like, even when he's not in the office, when we sit around,
the ghost of Kirkman.
Yeah,
is
it's
just
like Kirkman is kind of like hovering over me. And we a lot of the time, it's like, you know, what would Kirkman do? It's like, and there are a lot of things that we do because he's established his own rules and the mythology of The Walking Dead is a certain way. You don't have fast zombies. The tone is very grim. Yeah, and you just, you know, from reading the comics and watching the TV show over the years, you know, you just develop kind of like a taste test for like, that isn't tonally right. That doesn't belong in The Walking Dead. And so we're always thinking about like, what would Robert approve of? We're actually trying to go a little bit better than that. Like when Robert sees the finished game, there's two reactions I want to get from him. One is, "I should have thought of that." And the other one is, "Oh, that's disgusting. You can't do that in a video game." Yeah, we can and we will.
Suck it.
And again, there's no spoilers at all, but there is some stuff. By the time you get to episode 5, it is appalling. Some of the things that we've done with and to zombies and also to living people is pretty... We had a rule really early on when we were sitting around the table throwing out ideas. You know, there's no ideas in brainstorming, but you have to throw the bad ideas out there so sometimes to get to the good ones. And we always said, like, anytime we put out an idea that people go, I think that's going a bit too far, that is the stuff you have to put in the game. So anytime you go, I'm kind of uncomfortable with that. Yes, and that's why it's going in the game. We want to make players as uncomfortable as
that's
we made ourselves.
That's saying something for all the fucked up shit that's been in the comics.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, good.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you after about some of the shit. Oh, it's fucked up.
Okay. So now, I mean, was there ever a time when you guys sat down and you were thinking we're going to try to make this game a teen-rated game? It's rated M. This isn't usually what Telltale does.
Yeah, it's from everything I've seen, it's not just an M, it's like it's a hard M.
Oh, good.
You know, they really pushed it. And the great thing about the fucked up nature of our video game rating system is the only way you can actually get the rating above M is if you include any kind of sexual titillation at all.
Screw that.
You can tear people's brains off and cut their heads off and slash their throats, and that's all good. Anyone can play that. But if a woman starts like kind of making sexy eyes at you, oh, that's for adults only. We can't have that. It's terrible. And so we get to use that to our advantage.
Should we be trying to fix that?
No, I like it the way it is.
Okay, it's working out for you.
Yeah.
Now we made a bunch of jokes about Mass Effect there.
Yes.
This is now this big buzz thing happening in the industry, right? Of fans being angry at BioWare saying, well, we wanted to be controversial with our ending.
Right.
As a writer yourself, as somebody who creates content and puts out stories, there's a definitive end.
Yeah.
What is your reaction to these kids who are getting, not kids, players that are getting really fired up and getting into it?
If I were the guys at BioWare, I'd be thrilled with the reaction.
Yeah.
Because I kind of went through this myself. So the movie I made, The Book of Eli, was very controversial as well. It's a very polarizing film. People either kind of loved it or hated it. It was very little middle ground.
Yeah.
And I always said, I don't care if you love or hate it, as long as it gets a reaction out of you, as long as it gets people talking.
It gets your $11.
Yeah, and again, I get my residuals. I'm all good. And so if I was BioWare, I'd be using that as my brand. Look at how many people are talking about it. Look at the discussion it's creating. And that to me is a sign that you've done something right. So, and by the way, I'm very glad you didn't actually mention any spoiler stuff because I'm only halfway through the game and I would have physically murdered someone.
Yeah. I mean, we showed the ending. It's pretty clear.
I actually, by the way, that 8-bit, if that had been the ending, I'd be thrilled with that. Wouldn't you? Yeah. It's delightful. It's like you would not have seen that coming.
Like 90 hours of my life to get to that.
Well, it's not like the game is a chore that you have to slog through just to experience the ending, right? The game itself is a lot of fun.
Have you ever fought the Krogan?
Oh my God!
I'd tell you. What.
And you want a satisfying ending, and if the ending doesn't pay off, then yeah, it can kind of sully everything you've experienced up until that point. So I'm interested to see what I'm gonna think of it. And again, the great thing about video games, and this is the same thing is true of The Walking Dead. Like I was chatting to some people the other night about where we were in the story on Mass Effect 3. And somebody said at one point, do you realize we're all playing the same game, but we're all talking about completely different stories because the choices that we've made have created a different story. And the same is true of The Walking Dead. The choices you're going to make are going to branch the story in different directions. So we could all be halfway, like 6 months from now, we could be playing the game. We're both halfway through the game, but we're not halfway through the same game or the same story because the choices we've made have taken us on different branches. We can compare notes. And I think that's really cool.
All right. We'll have you back to compare notes. First episode of The Walking Dead out in April.
That's what you tell me.
Yeah. All right. Well. I'm going to blame you if it's wrong.
Thank you very much for having me.
Oh, thank you for coming on. Thank you guys for watching that extended interview with Gary Whitta. What's your favorite zombie game? Telltale would be really happy if you said Walking Dead. So like this video and say it in the comments below. And then make sure you watch the full episode of Up at Noon right here. Then subscribe to Start. All this, and my father's still not proud of me.